I have always approached research problems through the lens of my roots in physics. In this introductory talk, I want to share with you my personal history of thinking about associative memory and its relationship to neuroscience and AI. It was the fall of 1977. I was a professor in the physics department at Princeton. My office telephone rang. I was expecting an important call from a tennis buddy. I hastily answered the telephone, only to find Francis O. Schmidt on the line. He said that he ran the neuroscience research program at MIT, would be transiting Princeton next Wednesday, and would greatly appreciate a half hour, no more, of my time. I had never heard either of Schmidt or the neuroscience research program. Thought, what's 30 minutes? And agreed to meet with no further conversation. The following week, Frank Schmidt descended on me. He described an entity called the Neuroscience Research Program, which chiefly held small meetings in Boston, attended by 20 regular members and 20 visitors. Schmidt invited me to talk at the next meeting. I told him I knew nothing about neuroscience. Neuroscience being a word that turned out that Schmidt had coined only a few years earlier. He said that it didn't matter. Just speak on what interests you. That is what everyone does anyway. So I talked about my previous work on kinetic proofreading and the general issue of biological accuracy. I was captivated by the range of talks at the meeting. How mind emerges in brain is to me the deepest question posed by our humanity. It was being pursued in narrow slices as little problems by the NRP club of great scientists with diverse talents and lots of enthusiasm. But it appeared to me that this group of scientists would never possibly address the big problem, because the solution can be expressed only in an appropriate mathematical language and structure. And no one involved with the NRP at that time was comfortable in this domain. My basic education in neurobiology then came from attending these semi-annual NRP meetings, sitting next to world experts in the fields, who then patiently explained to me what the speaker was really talking about. Although Schmidt did his best to try to get the experts to lecture broadly on their topics and to describe neuroscience in an integrative fashion, he was generally defeated. So my introduction to neuroscience consisted of a set of disjoint expert views of experimental programs. I started thinking about cellular automata. Cellular automata are very special digital computers that had a brief moment in the sun in the late 1970s. They involve an array of equivalent cells. Each cell has an internal state that changes in time in a deterministic fashion, according to rules that involve only the internal state of that cell and the internal state of its neighbors. All cells are equivalent and change their internal states simultaneously. I first heard of cellular automata and reading about Conway's Game of Life in Scientific American. I surmised that a generalization or modification of that basic idea might be useful in understanding how a brain operates. I speculated that if cell state transition rules were made less rigid, more like the network of synaptic connections that provide inputs between neurons, and if the synchrony and time were relaxed to reflect neural delays in signal propagation and processing, it might be possible to bridge the conceptual chasm separating digital computers and neural systems. So in the fall of 1978, I began playing with corruptions of the game of life to make it slightly more like neurobiology, hoping to see it compute by following the state trajectory to an answer. Unfortunately, I was unable to carry out the mathematics necessary to follow the trajectory of the changing state for any such model. I needed to program a digital computer to simulate such a system and to do computer experiments to gain insight from a diversity of such models. The basic idea I wanted to pursue was that any computer, whether digital machine or brain, operates by following a dynamical trajectory from a starting point, which contains the program and data, to an end point, and that the trajectory needed stability against perturbation to get the right answer in spite of noise and system imperfection. I gave an NRP talk on this idea of neurobiology as a system that computed with dynamical attractors, but there were neither computer simulations nor mathematics to give credence to my enthusiasm. A young visitor, Chuck Stevens, came up to me afterwards to tell me it was a beautiful talk, but unfortunately had nothing to do with neurobiology. Most others simply ignored it. In 1978, Caltech was in the market for a new president. They turned to Marvin Goldberger, an eminent theoretical physicist who had chaired Princeton Physics. Caltech, with Delbrook on the faculty of the biology division, had been making an effort to have a more of a link between biology and physics. Goldberger had seen me struggling to do biological physics within the Princeton Physics Department. So during his honeymoon phase at Caltech president, he talked his faculty into offering me an endowed professorship jointly between chemistry and biology. Caltech Physics Department, dominated by the mindsets of Murray Gell-Mann and Richard Feynman, had no interest in making a faculty appointment in such a direction. February 1980. The quantum chemistry computing facility at Caltech is a splendid place to test out models and quite rapidly. It supported multi-user real-time computing, had great CCR displays, direct keyboard input. My research was a perversion of the intended purpose of this facility, but no one was watching. It rapidly became apparent that the previous year's speculation on the relationship of brain computation, cellular automata, and random networks was useless. Well, instead of trying to work on some of these things with more random networks, why not try a network with a particular structure chosen to accomplish some simple but meaningful task that neurobiology does well and that seems not to be natural to computers? The simplest such task in concept, and one that fits naturally into the basic computing paradigm of computing through dynamical system attractors, is associative memory. Associative memory is reciprocal. Seeing someone reminds you of their name, or at least did when I was younger, and hearing their name reminds you of what they look like. That fact can be expressed in network structure by making connections that are reciprocal. The mathematics of such networks is closely related to the mathematics of spin systems that are responsible for all the complex forms of magnetism in solids. I knew something of these systems through my connections with the theoretical physics at Bell Labs. Suddenly, there was a connection between neurobiology and physics systems I understood. Month later, I was writing a paper. This 1982 PNAS paper is the first publication in which I used the word neuron. It was to provide an entryway to working in neuroscience for many physicists and computer scientists. Further work connected these networks to many significant applications far beyond associative memory, including the emergency field of artificial neural networks. This work has also brought many statistical physicists into the field and created a foundation for the subsequent development of the Boltzmann machine by Smolensky, Sanowski, Hinton, and others, which played an important role in the early days of deep learning. Continuous associative memory networks also served as inspiration for the continuous recurrent networks frequently used in many AI systems and in computational neuroscience. One issue with what is now called the Hopfield network of associative memory is that it has a small information storage capacity. Given a collection of memory networks, memory patterns can only store and retrieve the number of memories that scales linearly with the number of neurons that compose the network. This is fundamentally unsatisfactory, since biological networks can store many more than the number of memories than sensory neurons, and can dynamically adapt these memories when the environment changes. I returned to thinking about this problem in 2015, when I was a visitor at the Institute for Advanced Study. At that point, I stumbled into Dmitry Krotov, a former high-energy theorist who was searching for an interesting problem to work on and who was excited by the field of deep learning. After several months of discussions, we formulated a simple mathematical model in which the memory capacity becomes decoupled from the dimensionality of the feature space, and for that reason, can be superlinear in the number of feature neurons, assuming there's a sufficient number of hidden neurons. This new model allows for a denser packing of memories in the feature space compared to the traditional Hopfield network. For this reason, we have called it dense associative memory. Importantly, we realized the superlinear memory regime is quite general and can be accomplished with any sufficiently rapidly growing activation function. This property is observed in both the networks of discrete spins and in networks of continuous variables that can be trained with backpropagation algorithm. This idea has found interesting relationships with transformers' attention mechanism, in which the tokens corresponding to individual words in a sentence are stored in dynamically calculated memories of dense associative memory. That way, the state vector of a dense associative memory, typically called the query tensor, attends to some of the keys stored in the memory buffer, informing the query vector about possible completions of the unknown masked token. Dima has also recently been telling me about the relationship between dense associative memories and diffusion models. Looking forward, I hope that the ideas of useful computation performed by physical systems will not only become helpful for interpreting the computational algorithms of existing AI architectures, I hope it will also inspire a new generation of AI networks that will have more powerful computational properties than current state-of-the-art models. Such a hope. Thank you.